know that you had this one particular question you wanted to cover that Resolve the Paradox accept.
Yes. I just reviewed the question again, and I got, well, it could be that I got the answer right this time because I knew the answer, but I feel like it's been getting smoother to deal with this question type. I feel like what throws me off sometimes is the word accept, because I think the brain just kind of tries to find the right answer. And whenever the word accept is thrown in there, it's asking for the wrong answer, right? So I want to know what strategy is best used for this question type, because I just feel like reading through the questions, reading through the answer choices, I don't really feel like I can spot the accept when I'm actually engaging with each answer choice. And I don't know why that is. Do you think that that is because I need more practice with this question type?
I think it's an accept issue in general, it sounds like, where it's hard to look for a not something. It's much easier to look for that thing. So here we have resolve accept is like the best way I would think of this question. Resolve the discrepancy, resolve the confusing nature of this situation, make this make sense. So four things help it make sense. One of them doesn't do that. The thing that doesn't do that could either further complicate it or simply have no effect. Now, I know you've studied philosophy, so you know about polar opposite versus logical opposite, right? So we're dealing with logical opposite here. So it could be either of those two things, no effect or the opposite or the polar opposite. So in this case, four help to explain, find those four, cross them out. Whatever remains is your answer. So you have to stay focused on cross out what does, cross out what does. Does this resolve? Yes. Does this resolve? Yes.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense, because I've also noticed that most of the answer choices, they don't resolve it completely. It just does like something minor, and it does help the argument. Or in this case, I believe this question that I asked you about was a fact set. So I guess it resolves the paradox exactly, but it doesn't do it like in a big way. So I think that's where the confusion can come in. And even if the correct answer, which doesn't resolve it, it's not so far off, you know what I mean? So I think that's where it comes. But also, this was question 21, so it's kind of towards the end. I'm sure it's like a more difficult question than, other questions of this type in the beginning. But yeah, I guess I just have to train. And I've noticed that sometimes I don't misread the question, but I think I neglect important parts of the question. I think that's really important to, read the question word by word and really understand what it's asking. And I think that I got the gist of that this week when I was faced with many questions that I didn't read properly. And I noticed I got the wrong answer because I didn't read the question properly, or because I had a misunderstanding about it. I think this question threw me off with the accept. Just like you said, the unless and accept words, they kind of, they introduce a new element into the question, and now you're faced with something new that you just have to do. So I think I just have to practice more with these. And also I also wanted to talk to you about must be true questions. For some reason, I kind of have trouble.
Let's get there, but I want to just add one comment to what you said about the resolve, because I think you raised an important point here I want to highlight, which is that the question stems here says would help to explain, and resolve the paradox will say helps to resolve. And so to be precise about it, you're absolutely correct that the four of them will help to resolve. It's not as if the four will resolve 100%. Like, this is strengthen, not sufficient assumption, to make an analogy there. So four help to explain, but they don't guarantee it entirely. They just make it make more sense than it would have otherwise. The other thing I want to highlight here is that you noticed that it was a fact set, not an argument. That's also a good way to be thinking about these things, and everything within this family of resolve, explain, those will typically be fact sets, not arguments. It's two pieces of information that don't seem to really go together. In fact, some would say that they're mutually exclusive, that they cannot both be true. And you've got to point out, of course, there's no such thing as a paradox in the real logical world. There's always an explanation for it. We just have to think outside the box a little bit and consider that alternative or additional information.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. I think this challenge comes in when you have to do it in a more timely manner. Right now, I'm not timing myself because I am introducing myself to the question types and going through them one by one. I think it will get a little more complex once I begin timing my sections. But I have some time for that. I think I might start doing that in July. I don't know. And actually, before we get into the must be true, as far as timing, you said that it's obviously, it's not a good idea to time question by question because some questions are more difficult than others. So you might want to do the easy ones a little quicker than the harder ones. But when would you say throughout your study process, like when would you say you should take your first absolute practice test? Whenever you're ready? Is it subjective?
Whenever you're ready, and that relates to whenever you've done, you've built the foundation, so you've covered the basics of each section, you've gotten a sense of what each question type involves, and it's even better if you've done at least a handful of timed individual sections first to work on your pacing, and then you pull it all together with full-length timed exams. As for when that happens on a calendar, I would say you certainly want to do it at least 3 to 4 weeks prior to your exam date, if not much earlier than that, depending on what your overall timeline is. If your timeline is 6 months, then you could start doing full-length timed exams maybe 3 months in if you've already built the foundation by that point. But if your timeline was only 2 months, it would take a larger percentage of your time to build that foundation.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, that sounds good. So I guess I'll start kind of getting more strict with the timing in a little bit, probably in a week, because I'm almost done with the foundational videos that you have set up, which by the way are very helpful and great, so thanks for what you do.
No, of course, glad to help. And so you had a question on must be true, right?
Yes, I did. I would say that I have some difficulty with must be true and most strongly supported. I know that they're very different because must be true is the must be true question stem requires you to find an answer that would 100% guarantee an argument, whereas a strongly supported one doesn't have to 100% guarantee the argument, but the answer choice would be strongly supported from what is given to you. So I think that for must be true, most of the time it appears in formal logic form, but sometimes it doesn't. And I think I have trouble when it doesn't, because when it's formal logic, you can graph it out and, you know, I feel like you could predict the answer better, but when it's informal logic, you can't. So I wanted to know what you thought about how to deal with an informal logic must be true question.
Yeah, there's a lot of varieties it can take. Mm-hmm. And it could simply be a paraphrase of the stimulus, or it could be a combination of two different facts from the stimulus. But there's not always a clear path. And that means that a mathematical formal approach just simply isn't going to work. Mm-hmm. In those cases, you might just do process of elimination.
Yeah. Yeah, I noticed that it was usually often a restatement of the stimulus, or it would combine two parts of the stimulus and that would be the correct answer. And for some reason, I would completely oversee it because I would think, no, that's too good to be true. But I guess that must be true then, right? So, yeah. I mean, that makes sense, right? But and as for most strongly supported, you know, I understand that like most of the time, the correct answer is connected to the stimulus as well, but I don't see how I don't know, I feel like again with that I have the same trouble as must be true. I don't confuse the two question types, that's not the trouble. I just have trouble when it comes down to two answer choices that sound good, and I know that you're supposed to kind of go towards the more moderate language for these question types, or I mean, for must be true. I'm not sure about most strongly supported. If, I don't know, is it moderate language for strongly supported as well? Does it depend on the question?
Yeah, I think anything within the inference family would tend towards more moderate language. But as you said, with the understanding that most strongly supported is not always going to be 100% guaranteed. It's simply what's incredibly likely based upon the stimulus, what would be a fairly reasonable assumption given the information.
Okay, that makes sense, yeah. See, when we talk about it, it makes complete sense, but when it comes down to it, sometimes it gets difficult, and it's usually from questions 17 through 26 when I'm faced with one of these questions. They really have a way with making things sound so similar, even if it's just one word off. It can throw you off because when you're reading it, it all sounds good. I don't know, it's weird. But whatever, I guess it's just something that you have to kind of get used to and expose yourself to more so that you get that practice, right?
Yeah, as it becomes more automatic, then you will be able to apply the strategies more consistently. It's when it becomes, through repetition, it becomes so innate to you that you're applying the proper technique without even thinking about it, or you've understood the language on a deeper level, like you're not consciously thinking about it every single time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, and then I guess I have another question. It involves pattern logic games. I've watched a couple videos, like I've done my own practice rounds, like when I go through my practice test books, and if I don't understand something, like I know your YouTube channel, like you have a lot of the games. So if you type in your prep test or section and the question, it'll come up. So I've watched a lot of them, and in most of them, you know, you also do add and say that, you know, pattern games, they come up sometimes and they're not too common, but when they come off, they throw off the test takers. And yeah, I don't know. I was wondering if there was like, because I've noticed in most of the pattern games videos that you've made as well, that they have kind of different strategies, but that's because you're given very different information in each question. So would you say that in order to do a pattern game, like because there's not really a solid explanation for how to go about it, would you say that to be able to successfully answer questions about a pattern game, you would have to learn how to do everything else, like matching, sequencing, ordering and stuff. And when you're faced with a pattern game, you would know that this is a pattern game, because I personally didn't know until I watched your videos.
I don't think that pattern games require anything about any other game type, really. I think it's more about being adaptable and flexible and realizing that although the game may have a different diagramming style, it may have a different fundamental principle at play. The same underlying things below that still work. So still understanding a rule, applying it consistently over the course of a game. Perhaps there are some inferences to make up front, reusing previous work. All of those things still hold. You know, a pattern game, to somebody who's never touched the LSAT, it could be that a pattern game is actually easier for them than a matching game or some other kind of grouping game. It's not uniquely harder. It just seems harder because it's infrequent. And so the way around that to me is to simply do a bunch of pattern games and then just what I call the curveball games in general, a bunch of weird, hard games, do them separately so that you can just get used to throwing yourself for a loop.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And going back to what I said about how you mentioned that in your videos that they don't come up often, just because they don't come up often, it doesn't mean that it won't come up, correct?
Correct.
Okay. So you definitely should get a handle on it. Okay. That makes sense. Man, these people know what they're doing, huh?
They do. They're very clever.
Okay, that's cool. And then I guess I have another question. As for reading comprehension, I noticed that there's a lot of questions that involve logical reasoning. Would you say that you would have to master logical reasoning in order to be able to master those question types in that show up in the reading comp section? Or do you think they're not related? Because to me, they seem related.
Yeah, they are related, and I think it would help. So let's say on reading comprehension, every now and then there's a parallel reasoning question. Those are going to be the hardest questions in reading comp, most likely, when they come up. But if you're good at logical reasoning, parallel questions, then they won't be as bad. Mm-hmm. But it's really just the exact same skill set applied to a much larger stimulus, but they're still narrowing to a specific area of that passage. So to me, it ends up being roughly the same thing.
Yeah, I noticed that. You're just dealing with a longer stimulus. So yeah, that's interesting. And I want to ask you a personal question. Which section, when you first started, came most easiest to you?
For me, it was actually reading comp. And that was just because I was a bookworm as a kid. I always loved reading. So to me, I had enough under my belt with reading that the reading comp passages weren't as bad for me. Mm-hmm. Although obviously there are some crazy hard passages that would still give me a trouble even today. But games, I think, is what was hardest for me initially. That's because it relates a little bit more to math in some vague way. And I was never really a math person, but luckily for me, at least, games are the most perfectible. So with the repetition of those, I was able to get those down. And now I actually like them quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're kind of fun. Yeah, I think I just have to work on reading comp, logical reasoning too, because there's just a lot of information. I feel like it's the section that you need to actually know more in order to do well on it. because you're faced with many question types and you have to go about them very differently. So yeah, I guess, you know, I guess using your course has been helpful, and I guess I'll keep using it until I don't need it. Hopefully we'll be good by October, because that's when I'm planning on taking the exam. So yeah, but I have time. I'm not nervous, just practicing for now. And again, I really appreciate, you know, everything you've done, because it's been great help, especially laying down the foundations. I feel like taking this course for a couple months will, you know, give me a really good score. And I mean, I hope I'm not wrong, but I just have that really good feeling.
Awesome, Carney. Well, it's been great to have you in the course. It's been great to have this meeting with you. Your questions are super nuanced and detailed, and that just shows the level at which you're studying. And you've been adding a ton to the group coaching and the classes as well. So please keep showing up. Please keep contributing. It really does help.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Steve. This was a good talk.
Thanks for tuning into the show. Please subscribe if you haven't done so already to be notified of new episodes as I release them. And feel free to reach out if you need anything at all as you move forward with your prep. I'm happy to help however I can. In the meantime, I wish you all the best and take care.